Bless his mighty name. We do brach ara abba for this great Shabbatons, a time of rest, time to be refortified and strengthened in the knowledge of Torah, that it may resonate, settle deep down within our bosom, that above all things our reliance is upon our Abba, and not upon things that we're able to innate or create, conspire to, or be inspired by, but our inspiration comes from Torah, from the testimony of great power of prophecy that grants unto a nation of people the strength, the koach, the might, the power, the revelation, understanding of Torah, that it exudes a certain characteristic that flows from them. It is evident, it is visible, it is seen, and it is a great strength unto one's life, Yisrael. We must understand that. We are people that our minds have been darkened by our own imagination, our concepts, our thoughts, our private interpretation of prophecy, that we believe that it gives us some kind of superior knowledge and preference before Almighty Yah, because we have interpreted the prophecy to our own satisfaction. It is not a prophecy of private interpretation. It is for Kol Beit Yisrael, for the whole house. If there's a profound revelation that is revealed unto any man, then it must be based upon, one must be, can I make a sidestep for a moment? We have in this nation what we call the most supreme jurors. And a jurist is one, you would call them a judge. But these are supreme jurors. We have in this land what we call the Supreme Courts of the nation. And those that are able to be confirmed to the courts of the court, then that individual must have a tremendous ability of a word we call jurisprudent. One that has the erudition to articulate the jurisprudence, the wise skills of the science, the mythology of law. And so what a jurist does in order for his or her, we have Miss Ruth Bader Ginsburg and we have Miss Stoudemire, that are the two female justices or jurists on the Supreme Court. And so what a jurist or a lawyer to enhance one's jurisprudence, because he extrapolate by his jurisprudence. He is wise, he is prudent, the scientific and the intelligentsia of law. So he has the ability to articulate. So what he does, he brings in what he calls law clerks, that they search the parameter of every case, every single word finite. They do what they call case study. They refine every single word, every dot, every sentence, everything is uncovered. They leave nothing uncovered. And so when he stands before the lawyers or sit, when he adjudicates a case, well, he has the jurisprudence, because he is a man that is a jurisprudent man. So he is a jurist because he has the ability to extrapolate from laws, from case studies. He has those that worked for him or she that have studied the cases that pertain unto this law and look for every loophole, look for every single word to express the dynamics of his judis or jurisprudence, that he is wise. And so when he or she stands, or when one is confronted by the jurors, then they use this term, you may hear me say, this erudition. They speak with such pronounced, profound wisdom. They articulate it so well that even those that have no ability to understand, they are convinced. It is not extrapolated through some kind of juvenile emotion. We find that among the house of Israel. In a time you find anyone that defends a thesis or a law or any aspect of anything in life through some kind of retribution that are juvenile, that one is sick in one's damn mind. There is something that is blatantly imbalanced in one. There was one of the community's clergymen that I ran across. And of course, when I run across him, he always wants to articulate Torah. And he doesn't understand that he is messing or dealing with a man that has jurisprudence of Torah. So I say to my Akh Ayabin, open the book for me. He had it on his telephone. I said, let's read this. And so when the man could not defend his theses of religious pomposity or his arrogance and ignorance, well, he resorted to this emotional stance against me. That's what he began to do. And my Akh Yabin said he got somewhat emotional, didn't he? Anytime we as a nation of a people, when we tend to draw from the strength of emotionalism to defend the theses of your private interpretation, there's something sick in your damn head. You're sick not only in your damn head, but you're sick in your spiritual application of matters. Because a jurist cannot go to court in the case of law and defend a matter without understanding every detail with great revelation of the concept that was revealed or the actions that were shown forth, that he may find the finest of reasoning in the minds of the people to put doubt. Although you may be guilty, it is his job to show or to sow a reason of doubt. And once a jurist can sow a reason of doubt, it is the impeccable skills of his jurisprudence, his wisdom, his knowledge of law, the scientific effect of law when the mind tries to articulate or perceive this profound quality of jurisprudence, of his ability to speak it and to perform it before the people, that they are convinced. They're convinced. It sows a doubt. And so the jurors say not guilty or guilty. This is a generation that the ignorance speaks profoundly. This is a generation that defends truth by emotionalism. But the activities of their emotionalism, that's not a jurist. That's not one that is wise in the mechanism of Torah. We must, if I must use this word, we must be forensics. A forensic is one that study each and every precise detail of the case. For example, you take a forensic scientist in whatever field that one is in, or a forensic investigator. When one goes to the crime scene, they just don't look at the body, or if there is a deceased body, they circle off a vast area. They circle off a vast area, and they search every little detail of that area. And it is the smallest of the minute thing that caused the case to be blown wide open. It's just a fiber, a thread of hair. It's a piece of bubble gum, a cigarette butt that is associated with that DNA of the person that is deceased or caught in the crime, that there's association with it. So we must be forensic. Our minds must be forensic. In order for us to have that forensic ability and capability, we must have the power of the Ruach HaKodesh. Because the Ruach doesn't come to speak of the power of this powerful innate ability of Yah that is in this living substance of life that's in you. But it comes to speak of that which has already been spoken. So a jurist will not draw a case unless he has a preponderance of evidence of that case that he can relate to. So it is with the Torah. You cannot determine or come to a determination without discovering or searching every aspect of this ordeal, the circumstance, situation that drew Yisrael into this complexity. You must search it all. And you're an ignorant man, woman, individual if you don't search it all. You must. That's why Yah doesn't give this to those that are weaned from milk. And that are not spiritually mature. We need wise men among us. There's a reason why I say that. I'm going to teach the message I intended to last week for my Achmichaya. He doesn't like it when I alter things here because he wrote me last Shabbat with great anticipation. Even my Isha is excited because I told her what you said. We must have the jurisprudence of great research. We are a dumb generation and we think we're smart. This individual that I confronted the other day did not want to. I said to him, come visit me and we will sit down. Give me one of your cards, your business cards, and I will call you. Well, I don't have one. Why not write it on a piece of paper and give it to me? Couldn't do that. So I gave him three of mine. You call me. I don't expect him to call me. This is a weak generation. It is fragile. Where are the men that stand in the Shekha, the gate, that open the gates to our minds to love Yah and to stand strong? I find a juvenile generation of men. And that's what we are. I find the Zachin as pugilant and weak as they come. No ability to retain from one day to the other the simplicity of things. And yet they think that they are strong in the Torah of Yah. You're not strong. We have no praying Zachin. And that's Zachinin. We have no mighty men of prayer. And these damn superficial Baptists of Zion that say that they pray and they intercede, they are liars. You can see the visage of one when one is truly a warrior. Even in my ignorant days, you could tell them those that were prayer warriors because when the house were open, they were there. And they would pray. You could see it in their countenance. In this damn superficial, I've watched it with the people that have lived here. I've watched those that come here and visit here. For some reason, the simple think that they are the ones that are persecuted or someone has this kind of animosity toward them. You don't have a damn thing. Why would I have animosity against anyone that come here that don't possess a damn thing? And that they are always suffering some your sin. You suffer because of your own damn wickedness, your arrogance, your superficiality. It's not because you're doing right. If a man suffer baptism for Sadiq's sake, we're not suffering. Not any of us suffering because we're righteous. Not one damn one of you. Yet a spiritual man, his wisdom speaks in the volume of his beauty. About the Zion, her beauty speaks in the volume of her beauty. She doesn't have to open her mouth. You find this damnable, loquacious generation that loves to talk. They have not studied to be quiet and to listen. I don't give a damn if it's this wife or your wife as well. I will not apologize to you, not one of you. Makes no damn difference who you are. When a man sees a woman that he thinks is voluptuous or beautiful, doesn't he or can he not recognize that? We can discern the face of the sky, and we can tell when it's going to rain. We can't tell when there's something spiritual among us. This damn silly generation. I'm going to teach Akmikaya. My friends, I greet you all. I greet you from the nations of the continent of Africa, Europe, throughout Europe. I greet you all from the various continents of the world, from Australia, wherever you are, from these United States, this vile reproach to Yah that proceeds from the belly of this vile, wicked nation. But I greet you all wherever you are, even though there are those that denounce those that are upon other continents and say that they're not a part of the house of Yisrael, and think that they don't have the wisdom and the understanding that is pronounced and much more profound than this wicked generation. And those that live in this nation, I greet you all in Kenya. I greet you there in Finland. I greet you there in Spain. I greet you in Ghana. I greet you in the land of Israel. I greet you in Dubai. I greet you in that section area we call Palestine. I greet you wherever you are, Israel. Every nation in every part of the earth, I greet the house Beit Israel, the elect of God. I greet you all in Yahshua's mighty name. I greet you wherever you are. I greet you there in Scotland. I greet you all. And those that will listen to this broadcast or the message, in whatever form they hear it, I greet you. Yahshua's most magnanimous, powerful, and illustrious name. I greet you in that precious name. I know that his people are scattered. I said to my Isha last night, we were sitting there before I went to bed. I went to bed when Zachin came on. I was in bed. I do apologize, my Zachin. And I went out because my body was tired. Sad thing about it, I awakened at 3:30 this morning. And so we were sitting there yesterday, and I saw this email come in, a gift, and it was an anonymous gift that came. It was a place of business in the country of Kenya. And so when I looked at the gift, I was astounded at the amount that one sent from Kenya. And so this morning, I wanted to see the converting of shillings into the American dollar. Listen, a shilling in Kenya is the same as $1 here, all right? You understand, on that economy, on that communal economy, one shilling is at the same value as $1. I recall when we were there in Kenya, there was a beautiful pocketbook my Isha wanted. So I approached the man, how much? He said, 3,500 shillings. He had translated that because he knew I was from America. I give the money to my akh, the pastor. He goes to the man, he gets it for 350 shillings. Vast difference, isn't it? And so when I look at the amounts that that individual sent, that's almost a year's salary, not almost, of many individuals. That's their yearly salary. So I greet you all there in East Africa, in Kenya, in Tanzania, in all of those countries. I greet you all, my akh, my akhim. Ma'achotim, I greet you all in Yeshua's mighty name. Because his people are scattered abroad, and this is an arrogant, wicked generation. We need men today that are jurists. We need men today that understand the jurisprudence. That they are jurisprudent. That they can articulate the law and the Torah of Yah, not with some damn mumbo-jumbo emotions or feelings, but they do it with the erudition of a man that is skilled and knowledgeable of Torah. They do it with the acum, the statesmanship of a man that understands the essential and has studied the case studies and knows and cannot and will not be backed down. You can't back me down with your emotions. You're not going to back me down with your juvenile interpretation of Torah. That you will not do. I don't care who you are. You will not back me down. If I'm wrong, you show me by your excellence of your jurisprudence. You have knowledge of Torah. You have wisdom of Torah. You have an understanding of Torah. You understand the application of Torah. And then you will show me your skill with your Judas, your jurisprudent. You are jurisprudent because you're able to articulate. You're able to speak. And every word is vital. And every word is of great significance. Shaul said that every word of Yah is pure. Shulomo. Not some, but every. Hallelujah. I'm going to teach Akmikayah. Simple message today. But it's going to enrich the hearts of Yah's people. It's going to enrich your heart greatly. That's why we must. God, I say this to all of us. We don't have time to procrastinate and pretend. A man taught me something years ago, Akmikayah. We will go to the assembly, and before he ever gave a nickel to this assembly, this assembly, by even before there was an assembly, my isha and our tithes and gifts and offering we had placed in an account. I didn't touch it for any personal use. We had given thousands of dollars to him because I love this man. I loved him dearly. I didn't have many men to stand by me. And I loved him dearly. And I will never forget, he said these words to me. He says to me, he was the one that began to call me Zakin. He was the first man to call me elder, pastor. I said, I'm your brother. He said to us, you all can call him that, but he's an elder among us. And he says to me one day, I will always be kinder to the next man. More kinder to him than he is to me. So I took that philosophy. I say, thank you. I'll buy that. And he turned against me like a vicious dog. And to show you my kindness was greater than him, I visited his house 3 times over these many, many years. He has never, I've called him. He wrote me a letter. I still have it to the day. I still have the letter. My heart was smitten what he said about me in that letter. I wept and I cried. I didn't denounce him. I said, Yah, search me. I don't want to be like this. I still have the letter, my Zachin Yeremiah. I can show you the letter. That's been close to 20 years. And I've been to his house 3 times. And the last time I went because I was bearing down from this book. They found out it was me. The one that came to the door came back and said, he's sick. Well, if he's sick, let him call for the Zakin. I'm an elder among Yah's tribe. I say, ask him, can I please see him? She goes back. She comes back and says, well, he is very sick. And his wife says, she doesn't know. I said, please tell them this is Re'ach David. Yisrael, please let me see him. She comes back the third time and said, he said no. His wife said no. I said, okay, yeah, I wasn't offended. And I've never been mad. Can I tell you, I will never go back. I will never go back to that place again. I shook the dust off of my feet. I will never go back. I will never try to inspire him to truth. And the things that I spoke those two times I was with him, he knew it was the truth. And he could not refute me. And so he allowed his emotionalism, like men do today. You cannot extrapolate from Torah. You're not a jurist of the Torah. You have no jurisprudence, knowledge of how to examine the Torah, and it makes you wise among the nation. And so the only strength you have is comparing yourself to others. I compare myself to no man. No man. I don't want to be like a man. I want to be like him. Jehovah said, you follow me as I follow Yeshua. I go astray, you all run from me. And so I put myself in a position for you all to examine me. I don't hide one damn thing. Nothing. I'm not false. You are false, but not me. I'm going to sit down today. Is that all right? My friends, how are you all today? You all are fine. I am too. I got some sleep last night. I went to bed when Zach came, when the music was coming on. I said, well, I can stay awake. I had talked to my Ach Shimbri. He says, I'm going to bed. He probably didn't get to bed till 11. Not me. I said, Shimbri, I could not even keep my eyes open before I came here. And the beauty of it was that Mama was in bed at 7:50. So it made it much easier for me to lie down. Clicking everything off, I hear the intro, I hear just this voice a moment, and I didn't realize it, and there was not even an eye awakened until 2 a.m. plus. And I'm glad, and I don't apologize. My body was exhausted. So I'm going to sit down today and teach for my precious Ach. He comes often, he and his family. Their gifts and kindness have been beyond kindness. I will say to them, I don't know what to say. All I can say is Toda. It's been a great strength to sustain the works here, and it has. And his gifts of kindness to me, he has always been kind to me. I will be wicked not to be kind to him. In order to have friends, you must show yourself friendly. So these hypocrites today think that they're friendly, but they don't even show themselves friendly.
Everybody's against me. Hell, you're against yourself, silly man. Yeah, but you, woman, nobody's against you. You're that juvenile. That's what children say.
Everybody's against me. That's silly. You're against yourself. I saw the children the other day, and one was saying, cry, baby, cry. Whoa, and my ears were in earshot. And the one that was saying that would not want anyone to call them cry, baby. I said, who are you calling cry, baby? So the person identified. I said, don't let me hear you say it again. Now, that little individual impugned that one, and that one is the crybaby too. That's how we do it. We always impugn others because of our like and because of our instability. The Torah commands us to examine ourselves and to take heed of ourselves to see if we are in the emunah. We always examine someone else to see if they are right. I've got enough examining me to see if I'm right. And then if I'm right, then the Torah commands you to mark a perfect man, one that is tomim, for the in or the gates of that man, for his conversation, his whole life is one of shalom. So you should know, if you are judging yourself, you should know one that is complete and right. Because we don't judge ourselves. We think highly of ourselves, but we don't think highly of others. Hallelujah. I don't want you to think highly of me. I don't need no accolades to support me. I found it all day in Torah. I found it all day in Torah. I don't spend 15 minutes in Torah. I spend hours and hours. I examine every avenue. I examine every word. I was looking. I'll get to that. Let me begin. I want to deal with the two major pillars of the strength of Yah's truth, Yahshua HaMashiach. The two major pillars of that great strength. We're talking about the strength of the kingdom of David. What was it established upon? And what was the ultimate strength of the kingdom of David's? He had a kingdom that was so pronounced that the whole house was ikhad. It was one. It was strengthened, and his warriors, one by the name of Mahaliah, were mighty and strong, tenacious men, no warriors. Not the warriors of David. Not even the warriors of Gideon. Well, how do you know? Because I've studied the warriors of David. I got a teaching on that. That one day in yours will, I will teach it. And show you them by name. I don't have time to play no damn video games. And look for folly. I searched the book. That I may become a juris. And my jurisprudent, the knowledge of Torah. I can see the power of that. And the testimony of Yahshua when he is uncovered. When there is a gala. When the uncovering of this profound power is revealed. And there are two major pillars of strength. In the power of Yahshua HaMashiach. That testimony. And if one doesn't possess that, they are liars. They have no strength of Yah's truth. It is the power that the Torah calls Sa'ad. It is what establishes us. It is what makes us strong. It is what gives us the assurance and the foundation. It is what sustains us. It is our support. It is our so'ad. So'ad. Our so'ad. And without the pillar of strength, you will have nothing. You need the pillars. I want to begin here, Israel, because there is something that is more important to this generation. And they're always looking for that. They're always looking for some kind of prophecy or some kind of noun word. But I want to show you the relevance of prophecy. It is important. But there's something that is greater and gives you a greater assurance. Not that prophecy is not as equal. But one that was wise with great wisdom. His name is Shlomo. He spoke in what we call mashal, in proverbial wisdom, that it was beyond the natural mind to perceive and understand. It had to be uncovered by wisdom. And we know that the beginning of wisdom is the fear of Almighty Yah. When a man doesn't yare, he doesn't fear Yah, he is a damn simpleton of a fool. He has no beauty of strength at all. When a woman does not fear Yah, when she doesn't reverence the head, she is beyond a silly woman laden with sin. She is a damn simpleton of a fool. And that's just the fact. You don't have to love me. Your love is not a value. I said to Akmikaya, I said, even my love for my wife, I'm not going to walk around the house all day, oh, I love you, I love you. I don't say that. My deeds, my actions, my interaction, my spontaneity, if that doesn't express that to her, then let it be. Love is greater than some kind of pronounced four-letter words. And that's a fact. Here's a matter of great wisdom, Shalom, in the book of wisdom. We must establish the kaseh, or the kaseh, the throne of Yah, upon the pillars of strength. That's why there is no kingdom power in us. We're the children of the kingdom, but there is no power in his people. He says in Proverbs chapter 29, this verse is relevant, and verse 18. As a young individual, when people would quote this verse here, it was not of great wisdom in their quoting and the revelation of it. He talks about this hazun. He says, where there is no vision, where there is no hazun, where there is no prophecy of Yah, where there is no communication by the Ruach of Yah, he says, where there is no vision, he said, the people, they will para, they will perish. They will show very lack of restraint. There is no restraint upon them at all. They will para, where there is no vision, the people, where there is no hazun, where there is no communication by Yah, where there is no uncovering of the profound utterance of Yah, then the people began to para. They began to show less restraint. There is no restraint in them because there are some ingredients that's lacking. There are no pillars of strength, Yisrael. He says that the people, they perish. They have no restraint, they para. But he gives us, and that word, you see that word B-U-T, but? You see that in the book, but. In our vernacular, it is a conjunction, isn't it? It states a fact, it states an identity, yet it implies that there is something that follows that, or it is used to introduce another category of words that is dependent upon that. Isn't that what a conjunction is? There is something that follows. There is something that follows. He says, although when there is no chazon, the people fail. He says, but, I went to the store, but. That conjunction states, and it's a fact that you went to the store, but that conjunction says there's something else to follow. But I forgot to buy the castor oil. I searched the Torah for the word but, and see how many times that's the student I am. You can acquire your knowledge in a different format. I must examine every word. And I searched the Torah for the word but, to see how many times that conjunction is stated in the Torah. It's stated 10,866 times. It's used in different formats in Torah. But it's stated in the Torah in the actual principles. You see, that's what a man of jurisprudence, to acquire knowledge, to be a jurist, he must examine that word. How many times it's repeated in the testimony of others. It's about 5,800 times that simple little words. And you know that there's always an altercation or an example that follows after the word buts. But. We need men that can somewhat understand the linguistics of the speech pattern. You know what a man can remember? The simplest of damn things. How is he going to remember the things that are dynamic? That's how simple I am. I need to know how many times is there. Because I know that there's a fact, but there is something that precedes after the words but. It is an indication that there is something that Yah wants to say that depends on all of that what was written before it. He says, but Yisrael, he that shemah, that guards and honor the Torah, he says, Isha, happy is he. There's a great buoyancy of the riches of Yah. There is a blessedness. There is a rejoicing. Without vision, you understand, I must lay this in order to get to what I want to. We are a nation that's looking for the hazun, for the prophecy, for words of prophecy, for someone to speak this nubu'ah, words that are accurate and precise, and they are genuine, whether they are true or whether they are false, my Zakin. So we want this nubu'ah, this prophecy. Yet, Shlomo says that a nation without prophecy, a people, then they will begin to para. They will begin to grow distasteful toward Yah. They began to lose any kind of restraint. When your minds are not in Torah, you will practice and do every kind of damnable thing, every lie, every kind of damn vile thing you will do. So we must constantly have a juris before us. One that will examine what's in the shecha, the gate of our minds, the gate of our hearts, the gate of our imagination. And although there is no nebu'ah, those that delight in Torah, you will see the very gleam and the gleaming power of this Isha. There's a brightness. There's a light. There's a knowledge of Torah that caused their hearts to rejoice. Unless that theme of what Shlomo says, if you can't find that resonating throughout the Torah, then it's a lie. You see, a jurist would search the Torah for the finest of details as to what and the reason when one delights in the Torah, they are full of the Isha, the blessedness, the happiness, the strength, and the maturity of Yah. We're never going to mature without studying the Torah. And we assemble ourselves in Yah's bayat. When a man truly walks in the ruach of Yah, he will speak on the things that you think you thought you know. It's one thing about my Zachin Jimri. He said to me when I had visited him, he says, you know what, Reach? He says that when I'm reading things, I will have my Isha reading, even on the way down there. Or I've read something before I got there. He said, there's never a time that you don't touch on that matter. You see, men today, they think because they have read something that it gives them a more insightful wisdom than those that would say, I didn't understand that. Now, because of the skills of the jurors, that I can understand the dynamics and the power of that, that it is the knowledge of Torah that caused me to be happy. And the man's face showed his happiness to know that that had been revealed unto him. This is important because prophecy or the nebu'ah shall cease. And only those ma'achmikaya that rejoice in Torah, a people whose mind that loves Torah, they are the only ones that shall be blessed and happy in the midst of all of the great plight and pillaging of death and destruction. Those are the only ones. The foundation shall be laid here. Well, why is it that this generation is always looking? I'll read what Yahushua said. But I want to deal with the aspect of two. Because that numerology of Torah, it is always an affirmation or a confirmation. For when one came to offer the sin offerings, two turtle doves. When Moshe came down off the mount with the tablets, there were two tablets. So you have to search that numeric order in Torah. Just open up your concordance, look at the number two, and see what two resonate, or see what scriptures are associated with that. The two goats, and everything deal with it. There shall be the two witnesses that shall come in the last days. It represents an affirmation. It represents a confirmation. And so I want to deal with the number two as I read. I want to point out two things in each scripture that I read, okay, today. All right? Now let us examine this in the book of Matthias, the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 16, verse 4. We are going to understand the kingdom of Yah. That was a physical and spiritual prototype in the kingdom of David when he established or saw that kingdom under the hands and the authority of David. And there were two profound, distinct pillars of the strength of that kingdom to establish the kingdom. Now look what Yahshua says here. Matthias chapter 16, verse 4. First of all, he talks about two things. He talks about a wicked. He talks about those that practice what Torah calls Risha. They are a Rasha, a Risha mind. A Risha is a mind that rejects Torah. It is a mind that defies Torah. He talks about a wicked, and he also talks about a nukhri, an adulterous generation, a mind whereby the images of idolatry consume their minds. Walmart and damn Kmart and every kind of damn thing. That is what nukhri is. It is the satisfaction of one's flesh. It is the power of the god of their belly. He's talking about a wicked and an adulteress. There is a confirmation. There is an affirmation there that a generation that is wicked, a generation that is a nukhri, a generation that has gone away from the love of Torah, a generation that has gone and operated or exercised themselves and the defiance of Almighty Yah because they go astray. And so you see the senility of para, generation whereby the Torah doesn't frighten them or cause them to get in line. A wicked and an adulterous generation too, isn't that too? First of all, he says they bakash, seek one again. He first of all identifies the generation. He calls them a wicked and an adulterous generation. Then he said there are two things that they do. They seek after an uth or a sign. Two plus two compatibles, a wicked and adulterous generation, and then that seeks sign, the compatibility. Yah says there shall be no sign given to it. He says, but the sign of the Novi Yonah, and then when he has said that, he left it there for them to ponder. They cannot reason in their minds. They cannot understand that. I hear from people today, all they want to hear about there is what they believe is prophecy. It's a wicked generation. It's a generation that is sleeping with every kind of image of their mind. Every kind of wicked god, they're sleeping with that. And so they're thinking that they're going to understand prophecy because someone has given them some nebuah, where there were false prophets as well. And they prophesied lies. And yet the lies were accurate. There are two things that prophecy do. You must study to understand these things. You must read the garment of Torah, the prophets. You can't do it in one setting or in a micro minute. It takes days, beginning with hours and days and weeks and months and years and years and years. You're not going to examine it all in one day. It's not going to come that way, Yisrael. There will be no sign given to this mindset that is full of wickedness, Risham. It operates in a defiance of Torah, without any conscience of Torah at all. But a man guards the Torah when he Shema, when he guards it as though that he's guarded with a hedge of thorns, that man is happy. When a man guards his mind from the insurgent of darkness, you will see that emanate in a man's face. I see some of the most damnable gloominess among men. I see Zacchaean elderly men that their faces so damn distorted and so hideous and ugly looking, disfigurement and that spirit is in them, and their face, it projects what's in them. There is no liveliness in them. And that's just a fact. And I'm not going to protect not one of us. I don't give a damn. We're dealing with our being. We're dealing with our lives, Yisrael. We become so set in our ways. We become unmovable. We don't want to change. We don't want to. We don't want to move from this damn wicked state of mind that we operate in. We think so highly of ourselves that we never can esteem our ark and our hearts. We don't want nobody to teach us wisdom and show us the fallacies of us and I. In order to bake a cake, you got to sift the flour first, put everything aside, and then you begin to incorporate the ingredients. You understand? See, those ribs were not just sprinkled with anything, put on the grill, and they were right. That was preparation. They had to be prepped. The steaks had to be prepped to be right. And so we couldn't do it in 1 hour before, but day before. You understand? I even shared some of my secrets with my friend. I don't care if he shares it. So when I can't cook anymore, he can cook. How about that? I want to give us one of the most profound constructs of Yah and this great design that he has created. And that was one that saw with profound revelation. He was known as Yahanan, the book of Revelation, chapter 22. And verse 18, just one verse, Revelation 22, 18. I'm going to get to the crux of it. It's important that we understand this. I'm sorry, Revelation, let me read this. Revelation 1, 3 first. Revelation chapter 1, verse 3. Now we know that these little 27 chapters here in Revelation, that's what, 27, which one, 27 to 24? These little books, these little letters here, this is not what you call a book or a sefer. It's not a book. It is a construct of writing. So he had to be specific when he wrote here. He says in Revelation chapter 1, verse 3, he used the word berach or baruch. He said, bless, Revelation chapter 1, verse 3. He said, blessed is he that, listen now, the two. He says, the one that kara, that reads, that recites, that can speak. When one reads a novel, they can tell you the whole gist of it. So he says, blessed with the great riches of Yah is he that's kara, he that reads, that cry, that speak. One that speaks out and proclaims what? Blessed is he that first of all he must read. And they that shema, read and hear. You must read, you must kara, you must allow those words to resonate in your mind and sing the songs of gladness. The two components, you must read. And then you must hear what? The words of this chazon, of this prophecy, of this vision, of this insight, of this genuine Pacific. These are Pacifics. And everything in Torah is Pacific. You can take out one ingredient out of a cake and it turns out right. Every word is Pacific. And every ingredient of the cake, it meshes all the other ingredients, that it comes out perfect. That it comes out palatable. So it is with the Torah. Blessed is the one. Blessed is the one that kara, that reads. And those that hear Shema, the prophecy to a God. Not only do they hear and read, but they Shema, they keep it. They guard it as one hedging about one's fist with thorns. And not only, but they keep those things that are, again, the two. Keep and written. There cometh, but yet there are two confirmations and affirmations in every verse of Torah. We don't look at it like that. Every sentence, we have not been trained to do it like that. There are those that call me, I said, I can't answer that in some microwave second. You want to take that and run with that. It takes years of deliberation. A jurist must deliberate a case. Are there lawyers or jurors that cannot try what they call capital murder cases? There are lawyers that are not equipped. They're not able to try a capital murder case. When people get the death penalty in basically every state, most of the times, unless one is able to afford a jurist, then there is a state-appointed lawyer. That's why there is always an appeal, because that lawyer is not capable of trying a capital offense. So then they must bring in seasoned attorneys, whereby the state must pay those attorneys to try that capital offense. So every lawyer is not capable of trying the capital offense, because that lawyer is not one that is wise. He or she doesn't have the jurisprudence, the skill, the knowledge of a capital offense, and so there is no jurisprudence, the power and the ability to operate, operate Yisrael with erudition to speak and to understand the finites of each capital offense. So that's why every man is not able to elaborate on those things that are of great wisdom. They're not. Every man wants to be a master. You're not a master. You should like to say to my natural brother, he would say to me, baby boy, I'm a jack of all trade. And he was a jack of all trade. Nothing that man couldn't do. I don't care whether it was electronics or anything. He said, but I'm the master of none of them. I can build you a house, but I'm not a master of the skill. I can put your nice system in here, PA system and all that. I can do your floors. And I can paint your walls. I can do all that, but I'm not the master of any. Today, everyone wants to be a master. And you can't be a master. Unless, if you're a master, you must relegate yourself to one Pacific. That's why there were the Levi, the tribe of Levi, that had no heritage or anything. They were given over unto being jurists. Everything was advocated, tried by the judicial process of Torah. And so those men then go out to the field and labor and try to ascertain some wealth. They labored in the Torah. And they not only had Kohan, but they had what they call the chief Kohan. That when there were things that were too, just like Yethro told Moshe, he said, there are things that are just too hot. You can't handle all that. And there are things that those that you place over 150-10, he said that they cannot handle. And when there are things that are beyond their ability to comprehend, they bring it to you. There was a reason why I'll point that out. And when the one, the spirit of harlotry, there were two, were there not? Was that not two whores? Just like Israel, Yehuda, and Ephraim, they're whores, are they not? We have squandered our riches away, Israel. There were two whores, and they both had children. They both had a child. And one rolled over and killed the other one. And the wisdom of Shlomo, he had to be wise where there were two proponents of his life that he had to have in order to make the right decision. I will show you. Don't worry about it. So he said, give me my keret, my sword. He laid the baby down and he said, damn it, I'll give both of you some. And when he drew back the spit, the ones whose child it was, she said, give it to her. She knew she would see the baby by and by. And his wisdom said, the child belongs to that one. Your shoe is not going to bed with this filthy whore. That's why the power of his testimony. That's why there's no prophecy among the people of Yah. These damn silly, stupid simpletons. Men and women don't even labor in Torah and think they have the spirit of prophecy. Don't worry about it. I'll get to it. They don't have the Nabu'ah. Hallelujah. He said, those that hear the words of this prophecy and the things that are written therein, for the time is at hand. We are in that time. It is upon us. And we must move with great pace, Yisrael. You must cleanse yourself from the filthiness of your flesh. You must change your ways. And so back in the days, I'm a brand new me. Just because of Yeshua, you're brand new. You have put off the old man and you put on the renewed man in the power of revelation. We should not look and act and talk like we once did. You don't have nothing more beautiful than anyone else. All flesh is filthy. It all stinks. We all took a bath this morning. And before you got to the dining hall, you will smell. I had to first of all clean my fingernails up because they were so dirty. Had to clip them off and scrub them in the shower. And before I get there, there will be the accumulation of the so bodiest decaying thing. There's no time to pretend. Yisrael, if a man gains the world today and all the riches and he loses his nefesh, his life, what has he gained? You can have $100 million and your body is not equipped. It's broken down. What do you have? I've heard many that were rich and powerful say, I will give all of my wealth to have a healthy body and a healthy mind. I will give all of it. I want to deal with an aspect of great truth, Yisrael, here in Revelation chapter 22, verse 18. I want to show us something here, all right? We're talking about those things that are fulfilled and those things that must be. Well, Revelation 22, verse 18. Hear these words, Yisrael. For I testify, or I bring the response from Yah. That's what a melech is, or melechim. They are messengers of Yah. A melech, they're messengers. They receive from Yah from the throne of the power of the testimony. So when a man is the true messenger of Yah, you will know it. I don't defend nothing by emotion. I don't assault any man, any woman. I don't assault one. I was telling Aunt Simeon the other day, yesterday, the man that died in our community, Stephen, some years ago, last year, that he and I would get into some tremendous debates. And I would say, my friend, I depart from you, but I disagree, you're wrong. And there was never an assault. It was never emotions, because I knew what I was talking about. He did not. I say, my friend Stephen, I depart from you today. We don't agree. And I have no problem with that. You don't agree with me? You don't assault. You don't take it out as that individual of the day. He assaulted my speech. He assaulted my words. You don't assault someone because your skills are primitive and you don't have the ability to articulate what you think is right. It's best to be quiet and learn and study. For I testify to every man, first of all, that hears the words of this prophecy of this book. Now you tell me he was talking about that little letter he was writing? Or is he talking about the Torah? Or he's talking about the wisdom of the Navi'im, the prophets? This is not a book. Revelation is not a book. The best it can be is a pamphlet. The book of Gilead now, we may call it that. It is not a sefer. It is not a sefer. So he was writing to let them know that all of his conclusions of prophecy was based in the Tasnith, in the beginning of Bereshit, until the Nobi Melchiah spoke. And everything they spoke of was the complete power of the volume of him that should come, will come, and has come. So he talks about a book here. You see how these light, let me read on. He says, I far testify to every man that hears the words of this prophecy of this book. The prophecy of this book. If any man shall add to these things, well, can I ask you a question? Are not men adding to the book? They adding to the covenant of Yah, the old covenant, the Brit Hadassah? They're saying that first day is right instead of the Shabbat. This man and I debated that. He said, well, every day is a Shabbat. I said, lie. I don't pretend with people. I said, that's a lie, man. I worship Yah every day. I said, that's a lie. I said, that's a flat out lie. Were you going to tell me, David? I knew I had him then. Because he become very defensive of him. Any time one become defensive of him, I'm set to defend truth. And that's what he should have been set to do, to defend truth. You go tell him, I said, I just told you. It's a flat out lie. It's not the truth. I said, well, let me ask you a question then. Who gave you the audacity and who gave those the inspiration to change the Shabbat from the first? Well, it makes no difference. I said, well, if it makes no difference, then why are you keeping the first? I said, herein is love, as Yochanan said, herein is love, that we keep the mitzvah, we got the commandments of Yah. And then so you want to attack my speech. Well, you're using words. I say, can I give you a story? I say, there's a sister. She's listening. She knows who she is. She sent a tremendous offering yesterday. I said, she calls herself a lowly janitor, and yet she understands my word. I said, you're a man of theology. You go to college. You're in college. The last time I saw you, you were in college taking classes. I said, if she can understand me, you can understand my words. When I define them, I'm a jurist, man, so I explain every word. I explain the details of my phraseology. And then he really got emotional. I said, I'm gone. I am gone, man. Bye. I defend truth. You can defend lies in your emotions. I defend truth. Can I read on? He said, the words of this prophecy, if any man shall add to these things, he said, Yah shall add to him the nigra, or the plagues, or the diseases, and the mark that are written in this book. Now, you can't tell me that this little writing of Gilyana that has, let me, what is it, 24 or 27? 22 book, 22 little letters. You can tell me that's a book? It's not a sefer. He's talking about the book that was written before he was reading that book. The book of the covenant, the book of life, the book of Moshe, the book of Hanach. You can add to that, Yisrael. Then he says in the next verse, if any man take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, this Nebu'ah, the prophecy is so genuine. It is so specific. It is not something that is a temperamental. It changes with people. It is precise. He said, Yah shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the Chador city and from the things which are written in this book. What? What book? How could he prophesy and speak with such elegance of knowledge and wisdom? Can I show you? Because he says something also in the 19th chapter. But before I go there, I want to go to Isaiah chapter 9. That this kingdom power shall rise up. Isaiah chapter 9, 1 verse, verse 7. And there shall be a melchut, a kingdom that shall be established, just like the kingdom of David. Before David was, he is. He is the offspring of David. He is the power, that living word that was in that kingdom that brought life. It's one thing about wisdom that men think they have wisdom. When a man has wisdom, as I was lying in bed in the wee hours this morning, wisdom always produces life, Yisrael. When a man speaks with the profoundness of wisdom from an experience, it produces life. It produces conscience in one. We don't have that today. We don't have that kind of wisdom today. We don't have the mindset where the jurists, that they have this jurisprudence, this experience in Torah. We find silly looking men. We find dumb looking men. They talk dumb. They have no command of Torah. When you don't understand words, when you don't understand the place and how applicable a word is, how are you going to tell me about the power and the dynamics of Torah? When a man gives himself to do that, then we disqualify him. He thinks he knows. No, I know. What I'm teaching today, I know what I'm teaching. I know what I'm teaching. I know what I'm teaching because I've labored the course. He says this. This is profound here. The greatest pillars of David's kingdom, which is a similitude of the kingdom of Yah. The physicality and the spiritual. For his kingdom is in us. And without the true dynamics of that kingdom, you are a flat out liar. It says this in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 7. It talks about this kingdom that shall be. It says this increase or the mabith of this kingdom. The words mabith or mabith, it says here in Isaiah 9:7. I had to copy this one. It is mabith. The word increase. Now we would think that that is something to deal with numerics, although it has. But this word mabith, it deals with the knowledge of the persona and the increase of wisdom. It's the profoundness of wisdom that captivates one. It says of the wisdom of his government or his mishra, his rule, his dynasty, his kingdom. He said, and of the shalom, listen now, there shall be no end. There shall be no cage upon the throne of David. He's talking about this is a kingdom that is after the kingdom of David. The increase of that wisdom or the mabeth, there shall be no end to it. It shall grow, and the wisdom shall be profound. And listen, and upon his kingdom, he is going to order it, kun, and he tells us here that it's going to be established. So as I read in the beginning of all things, he said, and his kingdom shall be established. It's going to be so'ad. This is how the kingdom shall be established. It's going to be established. Hear this, Yisra'iyah. It's not going to be established with prophecy. It's not going to be established with miracles. It's not going to be established with your wisdom. It's going to be established with two components. It's going to kun. It's going to be exalted. It's going to be so art. It's going to be established. It shall not falter. It shall be established. He shall establish it with judgment. And unless David established the kingdom of Yah with that, then this prophecy is a lie. And I will read you the power prophecy for us. Listen now. It's going to be established with judgment, mishpat, It's going to be established with the ability to properly adjudicate a matter from the book, from Torah. The resolve is going to be established with judgment, and the judicial process of that shall be pronounced for all to hear. It is going to be done with sadika, with justice. Judgment and justice, the pillars of the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach in any man or any woman. I will prove it. It is judgment. It is the mishpat when one judges themselves and adjudicate the case according to Torah. Will you judge that heart that is mishra and deceitful? Will you judge that nukri, that adulterous, lying, vile spirit that fornicate with every kind of damn god, your greedy god of your belly and the god of your lying conscience? His kingdom, the power of that nebuah, a prophecy, is established by judgment and also by sadaka, by the justice of Yah, by his character. Is not established by having houses and prosperity. There should be no end to his kingdom. And the pillar of his kingdom, it should be judgment, and we hate it. We want nobody to judge us. We will protect our wicked children when they are wrong. We will protect our wicked wives when we know they are wrong. We will protect our wicked husband. Woman, shut your mouth. Don't try to defend your man. You got no place to do that. And you will protect wickedness. I will not. I don't give a damn who it is. This woman knows I'm right when I say that. She knows it. She knows she lives with a man of integrity. See, if she had something on me, say he pretend he does that, she'll be running her mouth around all of y'all. But she cannot do it. She can't say he said that, but baby, he's doing that. See, that's how wicked women do. Oh, he said that, but he ain't about that. See, she doesn't have a damn thing on me. Nothing. Neither do you. Neither do you. None of you. His kingdom, unless my Zachin, I can prove this, I must have witnessed the Torah, then this means nothing. And as a jurist, I must study the case files to find this. In the mouths of the Navi'in, the prophets that spoke, I must find it. Not just in the Old Covenant, but in the Brit Hadats as well. This prophecy is about him that shall come. We know it's about Yahshua HaMashiach. And the power of Yah's kingdom. O great is he that has heard me. What's in us is the kingdom power. And the kingdom power, it flourishes because there is great judgment. If we would judge ourselves, we have no need for no man to judge us. Because we are such self-righteous people. Because we're indignant in our superficial, damnable, wicked ways. We don't see how vile and how corrupt we are. We justify our damn wickedness. We justify our wrong against Yisrael. We justify our children. We justify our wives. We justify our husband. We justify every damn thing but truth. Every case must be adjudicated in the order of Torah. And everything that, and what precedes everything is judgment. You got to judge. When a man is righteous, he judges all things. He's not judging any man because he knows how he stands with Yah. That is the pillar. Those are the pillars of the kingdom of Yah. Judgment. And Sadiq. Sadaka, the righteous character of Yah. You don't have that, you don't have a damn thing. And we despise this judgment. Even when we are wrong and we know we are wrong, we want to justify our wicked wrong ways by some kind of emotional tantrum. Don't do that, Yisrael. It's like a man getting mad with his wife because she's not walking right, and he goes into this emotional tantrum like a child, or a wife, vice versa, or you with your uncle, with your hota, or they're against me. No, you're against them, Jezebel. You damn hypocrite. That's what you are, woman. Don't come to me and tell me that. I don't care what transpired between you and any. Well, you all can think what you want, and she doesn't come and tell me or talk against you. I don't care what you think. There's something she repeats, something she hears. And when she does, I say, what? Oh, it's not anything. Oh, hell yes, it is something. Because if it wasn't something, you wouldn't remember it. I love me because me keeps me straight. I love me. You don't have to love me. I love me. I love me. Me keeps me straight. And when you love me, me will keep me straight. Because you don't love me, you don't love you. You will not keep your mind straight. That's why you incriminate and indict others, and you're wicked. That's why there is no hasid, no mercies. Man goes, and says, yes, sir, you are. I'm wrong. I done did wrong. He goes before the jurors. Yes, sir, I'm wrong. You will hear many cases where he showed no remorsefulness. She showed no remorse. When a man showed that, then many times the judge's heart will be changed. And although there is a standard sentence, he's a jurist. And his jurisprudence will cause him to use his jurisprudence, his knowledge of law. He says, boy, you know you get 60 years. I was going to give you 8 years, boy. And you said, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Because the judgment of Yah is not expediently rest upon us. Because he does not acquire us and require us to pay right now, then the heart of man is fully set to do wicked. You love me, you would tell me the truth. And people get offended because you're so honest with them. They think, well, he doesn't care. No, you don't give a damn. Because I can say you're a pack of lies, you will believe it. You don't give a damn. Because I'm honest with you. And someone is honest with you. Child saying, no, mama, well, mama, that ain't going to happen to me because it happened to you. Baby, it's going to happen to you. And it's going to be worse. And that's how dumb we are. We are dumb. We are dumb. His nation. It's a fact. Let me move quickly. It says that he shall sa'at in Isaiah 9, 7. He's going to establish his kingdom with judgment and with justice. Why? From this point, even forever. That's what the kingdom shall be like. It says the zeal of the king, of the zeal or the jealousy of Yah of Sabah will perform this. It is what's going to perform it. Yah's jealousy. His kingdom is going to be established with mishpatza and his sadaqa. And if you don't have the judgment of Yah or his righteousness in your bosom, you have no kingdom power. You have no kingdom power, Yisrael. That's why we constantly revert back to the same old puke pile, like a swine and a dog. And that's why Yah say, don't give that which is kadosh unto those to the dogs, and give that which is not kadosh unto the pigs. They're going to trample down the world. We got a pig spirit. We got an unclean spirit. There ain't nothing clean about our ways, Yisrael. We must come to the resolution of that. There's nothing clean about your ways or my ways. There's nothing clean when we come to that. Then we will allow the kingdom power to be established. There's only one sure sign of that kingdom power in us. Quickly, Revelation 19. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have no hazon unless you have this testimony. Revelation 19, verse 10. This is what Yahkahan said, and I fell upon, and I fell at his feet to Shahat, to worship this Melach, the messenger of Yah. And when a man brings forth the unadulterated pure word of Yah, it has come from the throne of Yah. It is not by his intellectual capacity. He has shown himself to be a student and one that loves Yah because he's given attention to the Torah of Yah. And when he stands before the nation, Yah opens up or he gala uncover the profoundness of his truth. And I fell to my feet to worship this Melech. And he said to me, "See, my friend, don't do that. Don't worship me." Listen to what he says. He said, "I am your avadim," or "I am your avet." I am your fellow servant. He says, "And also of your ach." He said, "You must understand. Listen." He said, "I have the edut or the edah. I have the testimony of your Yeshua HaMashiach. His kingdom is established by judgment and justice." He said, "I have the testimony of Yeshua HaMashiach." He says, "Worship Yah. Worship Almighty Yahweh. Worship Yah for the testimony. For the testimony. That's why you will worship Yah." He said, "For the testimony of Yeshua is the ruach of prophecy. Nebu'ah. Nebu'ah. When you have this kingdom power of the witness of Yeshua in you, it is the revelation of all prophecy of the book that was written. And that's why you got men today scrambling trying to understand Gilyana. They don't understand. In order to understand Gilyana, you must be a Jurist. You must go back to the Bereshit of all things." And they're trying to get the power of this testimony without understanding the operation of the testimony of Yeshua HaMashiach. And without the Ruach of judgment, and without the Ruach of Sadak for Yah, for he, Almighty Yah, his Sadaka is an everlasting Sadiq. And his Torah is the truth. And they're trying to get revelation from one verse that Yah said, and yet they have not seen the power of that Nabu'ah of what Moshe spoke of it. It doesn't operate that way. And we got the simpletons trying to instruct, and they need to be taught themselves. I don't bow down to no one. No one will I back down. And that's what we have today. That's the Ruach of prophecy of that prophecy that I read with Yeshua. That is it. Yeshua is the power of that. He's the revelation of that prophecy of Yeshua 9 and 7. Of Isaiah chapter 9, verse 7. This is the true. When we have the true testimony of Yeshua, they will truly worship Yah. When we are staunch and stiff, you don't have the testimony of Yeshua. You can say what you want to. Here we go to Dollar Mark. We got the testimony of that. I watched my little ones in that Dollar Mark. They were moving like, man, they knew how to move. "Oh, you see that? You see that? Oh, I'm going to get that. I'm going to buy that." They didn't realize the $10 don't go very far. "Nah, can I get that?" "No, you got that. You got that. You got that. How much you got?" "Oh, that's $8. "Now I want to get this." Oh, they had the prophecy of dollars, so they knew exactly where they were going. "Oh, you condemn them? That'll be so silly. Unless we can become like one of these little ones, we're not going to enter the kingdom. They're so delegated and so dedicated and so delicate in their approach to things. We don't have that. And we must garnered that. And we do that by the Ruach of judgment and Sadaka. We got to be righteous. You don't justify anything that's wrong. You don't justify anything in you that is wrong. That's why we learn how to confess our faults one unto another. Then we become more effectual and fervent in our prayers. "You don't like me for what? Why you don't like me? Well, what do you think is wrong about me? Tell me what's wrong about you. It's amazing I can tell you what's wrong about me. Let me tell you what's wrong about me." That's the beauty, isn't it? You go to your halt, your architect, "This is what's wrong with me, man." Nobody does that. I don't have no problem with that. Because this is for me here. It may not be for you. But my boss speaking to me because he loves me. Every son that he received, he chastens. Huh? And corrects. be time. So I'm his son. He received me this morning. I know he does. So he will correct me. There's no time to ponder the blessings of riches. We have, happy is the man that loves the Torah of Yah. Happy is the man. Happy is he that keeps the Torah, that guards the Torah. When a man or woman guards the Torah, they're happy. I'm not talking about this superficial grinning and laughing. Everything is funny. That's not happy. That's silliness. That's stupid. You think he would go for an interview or for a job and the man said, we expect you to work this day. That's not funny. That's an immature nature of anyone. I just tell him several times, it's not funny. I say, I'm not laughing. I'm serious. You may think it's funny. Well, you know, it's not, and all this skinning and grinning and all. We need to be sober. Elders need to be sober. I'm not talking about looking like a damn monster, man, with your face and contorted. I'm talking about there's a soberness to wisdom. It speaks with volume. It speaks with radiance. It speaks with light. Even the world knows that there's something different about that man. I'm not going to stop saying it. When I go, they know that there is something about that man. No, I'm not the tallest, not the finest. Not the most intellectual one. I command that. I'm a son of Yah. I'm of the house of Israel. No, you can relinquish. Yah said that we shall be a blessing to the nation. We are a segula, peculiar people. I want to look peculiar. Hallelujah. Can I proceed a little further? It is the zeal of Yah in Yeshua said that shall perform this. He's going to perform it. Now the prophet Amos, he speaks here to us as a nation. I'm saying this to give us great clearance that we need to change our ways. We need to shuv or make teshuva. Amos chapter 5 verse 15. This is how you know you're really progressing in Yah. Amos chapter 5 verse 15. I will not stop saying what I'm saying. That's why the bath of Tizayon, you elderly, you Zachim, you mothers, you Ima, you must teach the young women how to love their husband, how to keep their houses clean. I can't stand. I have never liked that. And a frivolous Jezebel of a woman. If she's a Jezebel, she is one. She doesn't keep her house clean. If she can't teach the young women by submitting unto me and a love for me, let her go to hell, and I mean that. She has no other responsibility but to teach the women how to clean their house, how to honor their house. That's what mother-in-laws do with their daughter-in-laws. If they love them, if they don't give a knicker's worth of rat's ass, they don't care. They can see them sleep in the filth of filth. But if they love them, they will show them and teach them. Get off your lazy arse. Mothers ought to teach the young women how to love their husband, to honor them, to be chaste, to be cleaned, and to keep their houses. That's what they need to teach them. Mothers need to teach the young girls and the young Baptists on how to be beautiful, not showing off their eyes. Learn how to be submissive. And you do that by showing how submissive you are. You don't do that by talking. When others see you, folks don't like when I talk like this. We go places. Everyone that sees us, I don't care whether they're young or old. You know, I watch people as they watch my issue and I see it all the time. I don't care whether you buy it or not. I see it all the time. And they see something there, young and old. Because she knows I will rebuke her too. I'm not going to abuse her. To shut your mouth, woman. Don't come to me complaining about nobody. What are you doing? That's right. I ain't taking him back. Hallelujah. See, a weak man would take the side of the weak woman. Oh, when she comes to you complaining, she's weak. That's a fact. He must use judgment and judge. Nobody's against your damn wife. Nah, the world ain't against her. Nobody against your husband. You're just against Yah. You're not living that right that people are against you. Can I read this here in Amos 5:15? He gives us here this great catalyst to to make teshuva. He said, first of all, hate the evil. And we must ahab, we must love the tub. And then how you do that, look what the word he used. Again, he used the word sa'ad, doesn't he? He said, establish. He said, this should be your support. He said, this shall be what uphold you. He says, you must establish what? Judgment. Is that what it says? You must establish the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. You must establish judgment in the gate. It may be that when Yah, the sovereign master of hosts, will be chanun or benevolent or acceptance to the remnant of Yosef. So we must establish that pillar. We must establish the mishpat, judgment in the gate. We must establish in the gate or the shachar, the gate of our mind, the gate of the entrance of concepts and thoughts. We must establish it by judgment. We must establish that by judging our own spirit, judging our attitude, and judging how right we are as we assess the matter. We can't assess matters out of a corrupt spirit, out of the mind of Risha. We can't assess that, Yisrael. So we must establish judgment in the beginning when we hear the matter entering to our minds. We must do that. Yeah. I've had hypocrites here with us. I had the wives, the husband, and all the women think that everybody's against them. You all been here with me, you've seen it. You got the husband think that they have been persecuted for what? I mean, people that never gave a damn dime. They were no support to us. And these were the ones that always brought the accusations. This man has never said that. And he gives a lot of money. Him and his wife, his son Sophonia, he's never said that. And I've watched them here that they have come. I've watched them that have lived here. First they go, well, everybody's against me. Oh, you hypocrite. You're against truth. Nobody's against you. It's your own wickedness condemn you. If a man's own heart, your own mind condemns you, God's greater than that. He's trying to let you know, check yourself. You don't have judgment. So when your heart condemns you, you say, he's against me because you're wicked, man. You got to be a sick creature to think everybody's against you. If you're against me, I don't give a damn. I say it that way. I don't frankly give a damn. Because you against me doesn't stop me from eating, doesn't stop my rejoicing, doesn't stop my love for Yah, doesn't stop my love for Yisrael, doesn't stop my concern for the whole house. I don't give a damn how you think. It doesn't stop anything. We must establish that principle in the gate, judgment. And Shecha, Zakeh Benjamin can speak on this, that Shecha is the gate or the entrance. It is the beginning of the development of the concept. You ever began to think on something and you know it's wrong? I've done that. I know you all are self-righteous. You're beyond that. And then all of a sudden it began to develop, and you know that it is wrong. And your mind, all of a sudden, it has to be a great repentance of that. So you must establish, you must add. This must be the strength and the support of everything you do. You must establish judgment. And you show that there's a sign of judgment in your teshuva. You must repent. You must change. You must alter the course, Yisrael. We're not going into the kingdom of Yah. We're not going to have the power of this kingdom in us with all kinds of nukri or this adulterous type spirit where we have no love for Yah. It's not going to be, Yisrael. And when one has that, listen, people will understand and they will know. Can I show an example? Will you bring me my ema? All right, let me show you here in the book of 2 Chronicles or 2 Dibricha Yaim. 2 Chronicles, chapter 9. I want you to turn there, all right? Hold that 2 Chronicles, chapter 9, and go back to Proverbs 29, 18. 2 Chronicles, chapter 9. And go back to Proverbs, hold your hand in each place. Get 2 Chronicles chapter 9, all right? And then turn back to Proverbs 29:18. I want to show you something now. Prophecy, answer, or Torah. Torah not only does it quantify, it also speaks and it identifies with witness as to the truth of it, all right? Now, I read in Mishli, Proverbs 29:18, he says, where there is no chazon, no vision, where there is no nabu'ah, no specific and genuine prophecy, it says that the people, I use the word para, they perish. Or they began to show lack of restraint. They don't show great love for Yah. And then it says, but I use that conjunction. And the word but, it is placed there. And in our vernacular, there must be a comma behind it. But there's a semicolon between that first statement and but, isn't it? But, it says, because it is what is following is a fact. And that is an amendment to the statement. But it says, but he that keeps the Torah, happy is he. We believe that? Now, when someone keeps the Torah, even those that are strangers will understand. Can I show you, my bad? Now go to 2 Chronicles, chapter 9, verse 7. I'm not one that pretend. I searched the book for my life. I was thinking this morning, I said, Yah, you know, I really thought this, might be honest with you, my young Aholt. I said, Yah, even if I die, you know, when you take me, I don't care. I say, they can just leave my body. No one finds it. Just let the skin worms and the buzzards eat the flesh. I don't have no problem. I don't fear that. I don't fear the power of death. Because death has no sting over me. I said, they can leave my body. And that, why would I be thinking something like that on the Shabbat? It's silly. But that's the way I think. I'm just honest with you. We think like that. Oh, the buzzards. We had a goat to die the other day. Simeon and I said, man, we can't get the back hole in here. I said, I'll take care of it. Don't worry about it. I said, no, you take care of what you have to. I got it up. You want me to tell you how I took care of it? Can I tell you, will you believe me? I saw the buzzards up there. I said, boys, go and eat. Don't worry about it. Won't be long there. It won't be nothing. I go back there, nothing but bones there. I say, my friends, come on. There he is. I didn't have to tell them where that thing died. He had already begun to decompose. You could see the stages of flies on it. And I wasn't about to dig in that hard rock. I wasn't about to dig. And I know that the buzzards would eradicate any kind of disease or anything. I said, come on, buzzard boy. Come on, boys. And I saw them flying over there, and I saw them land up in the tree. I said, you got him. Come on down. The vulture. Correction. They see you so concerned about that, all right? And I saw the vultures, the buzzard, as I was a kid, we would say. And I saw them come and say, we will handle this correctly. And they did. So unless this Michelle that Proverb 29 spoke, he says, happy is he that, but he that keeps the Torah is happy, is he. Now that must be something to qualify that. It says in Debri Chayim, 2 Chronicles, chapter 9, verse 7, when the queen of Sheba saw, this woman was a heathen, when she saw the magnificence of Shlomo's reign, the first thing comes out of her mouth is Isha, she says, happy. Is that what it says in your book, 2 Chronicles, chapter 9, verse 7? Does she say happy? Did not Shlomo say that? Did not the wisdom of Yah speak and say that happy is he that keeps the Torah, happy is he? Did it not say that? Did not she said, happy are your men? Didn't talk about the women, talked about the ish. There's nothing more pronounced than the strength of a man, his physicality. She said, happy are your men. Why? See, we think we're happy because there's an element that's missing. She says, happy, happy are your men. And happy are these, your servants. Now that's profound to me. Not only were the men happy that served him. He said, but happy are your servants who stand. They can stand continuously. They stand tomin. They stand perfectly. They stand perpetually. They stand continuously before you. What? Listen now, the two here, not only but for to hear to Shemak and his chukmah, to hear his wisdom. That's why they were happy, because they could hear the wisdom of Shlomo. The two, the affirmation, the confirmation. They were happy to hear Are we happy to hear the wisdom of Yah's judgment? Are we here happy to hear the wisdom of Yah's justice? But she said, happy are these, your men. There's nothing that propels a man with great strength when he is happy. Nothing. That's why Yah commands a woman to submit. He commands both of you all to submit in yourself one unto the another. And then he says to the Ishah, then you be subject unto the commands and the laws of your man. This damn effeminate spirit has taught the women to be just like these fat dogs. And these mamas have raised half-baked faggot boys. They need a man. I heard a young kid the other day, I promise you, these young women, they asked the question, well, your mother taught you how to be a man. He said, she couldn't do it. My mother and all her, she taught me how to love. She taught me how to care. But she couldn't teach me how to be a man. She could not. You hear the young women say, my mother, she taught me things, but she didn't teach me the beauty of the love of a man. You said, my life is not just messed. I don't need to love a man. I don't need to love me. Yeah. You think you're getting by, but you're not getting by one damn bit at all. You think a little baby's even that big, even that long. They can see when the mother is out of order, they just look. They don't comprehend it, but they know damn well. They can see when the man is not right by the mother, they know there's some innate ability they can discern it. You think you're getting by? You don't have the power of God's kingdom in you. The power of the pillars of his kingdom, whereby everything rests upon. It is judgment and his tzedakah, his justice. This woman, this queen, she said, happy are those that serve you and they stand before you continuously. Why? Because they want to hear, they want to shema your wisdom, your understanding of Yah. And then she says in verse 8, she says, Barak, Baruch is Almighty Yah your Abba, which delight in you to set you over, listen now, not your throne, but it says his throne. You see what he does? He sets us over his throne. To be Melech, to be the king, the ruler. For who? For Yah, your Abba. Because your Abba loved Yisrael. And we go back to that word, sa'at, to establish them forever. Therefore, he made you king over them to do what? To do what? To do what? To do judgment and justice. This is the prototype of Yah's kingdom. We despise judgment. We don't want no tzaddikah. He made you king. He was a man of Torah. He was wise in the Torah. Shlomo's downfall did not come because he had damn lions in the house. The house was given by the design of Yah, damn it. Yeah. Devarim 16 say, Yah was the one that gave the design to David. And David gave the design of the house of Yah unto Shlomo. Yah designed the ark. Yah designed the Ark of the Covenant. He designed the earth. He made him king. He made him king for one thing. To do justice. To do judgment. When you find a man of the royal courts of Yah, his heart ponders judgment all the time. That's why he doesn't practice sin. He's not a liar. He did not address the women. He said, blessed are the men, happy are the men. Esha, that stands before you continuously. When you search out the word perfect, perfection, tomim, he used the word tomim. He said, they stand before you in the perfect order of Yah. And they stand before you continuously. You understand. Why? Because he knew. He knew that's why he gave. He did not give David. He gave David the blueprint for the house. And that house or the tabernacle represents the prototype of what we are. That our hearts should be upon the 12 tribes, even as the 12 lions were in that house of Yah, that each represent one of the tribes of Yisrael. That's what they were for, my bad. It is always significant. Every kind of hazon that Yah gave unto the messengers, they were types of images and emblems and signs and all of that, even signs unto Yisrael, even a budded fig tree. That's what he calls us. This damn stupid generation, we're ignorant. I will come on, man. I don't give a damn how y'all feel about me. I'm not cursing, my bad. This is going to take this approach for us to get right. And that's just a fact. This is what Yah said. The prophecy of the kingdom that shall be established in Yeshaya, it was one that was established in judgment and justice. And this is the prototype of that kingdom. I will flush it all out. Don't worry. Don't worry. I don't sit and read 3 or 4 chapters and think I got something. I don't try to look for things that do not mesh with the veritas neath of what I'm teaching. Everything I say, I teach on one word, my Bath. You know that. I don't try to explore all the other options and try to integrate things that's what a jurist does. Because his jurisprudence has taught him everything that pertains to this case, you must do case study of those kinds of cases. And so you must get the law clerks to fetter out everything that is vital. But they said this, and this is the same word that resonates throughout the theme of all the testimonies. And he must attack that word. You understand? That's how they resolve cases. And that's how the erudition of a strong enough lawyer, that's why he wins. He has to be theatrical. He has to do it in a way that display his jurisprudence of the matter. We need men like that. We need men to stand. Happy are you. You must keep the Torah in order to be happy. You must. You can't keep your silly ways. You can't keep your immature juvenile indulgence. Can I proceed a little further? This is how his kingdom was established, right? That's what it says. He said, I will establish your kingdom forever. Didn't it say that? He says, we'll establish them forever. Does it say that in 2 Chronicles 9:8? It says that in 2 Chronicles, a lot of part of 9:8. Does it say establish your kingdom forever? It says that. Well, hold on to that and go back to Isaiah chapter 9, verse 7. Hallelujah. It says in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 7, it talks about he's going to establish his kingdom with judgment and justice from this point forevermore. Is that forever? Is that forever? Is the same word? You cannot diminish the power of the wording of Torah and just take a statement and think you have the wisdom of that. So the same words used, are they not? Are not the same words used? Same words, Yisrael. You may not like me, but I'm on the money in what I teach, all right? I'm on the money. And Yah's going to have to break the back of this hoe. We are hoes. We are flat out hoe. A hola and a holaba. Yehuda and Ephraim. We love to hoe. We love to nukri. He's like, I like to get me a little nuki. See how words, see how we say things that we don't understand? A little nuki. Nukri. You love to be a hoe. That's what it is. I shall my friend to die. Hallelujah. Now to show us that no powerful kingdom, not even the kingdom of his testimony in us, if this is not the pillar of it or the pillars, if this is not what established it, then the whole book is a lot. Throw it away. To give you confirmation, affirmation of the two, the twain. Quickly, 2 Shemuel, 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel chapter 8. Prove me wrong. And if you that listen, prove me wrong. You that are gathering, prove me wrong. You can't prove it. Can I read this, what it says in 2 Samuel chapter 8 and verse 15? One verse. It says, and David reigned, he ruled over all, kol, the whole, the substance. David, 2 Samuel 8:15, and he ruled over all Israel. Does it say that, Israel? Yeah. He ruled over the whole nation. When all the 12 tribes met back, they were united. They had reconciled unto Yah by the wisdom of David. You understand? It says, and it's only when Shlomo began to move away from Torah, when he began to be a gross of gods, he loved those women that were Esau. He loved the Hittite women. He loved women. And he began to build groves, not because he built the house to honor Yah. And Yah put his name in that house. And the house was filled by the cloud of Yah. And his beauty, he sealed the offerings were in that house. It wasn't that, but David, he reigned over Yisrael. And David, he executed. Does it say he executed judgment? Does it say he executed judgment? Does it say he executed justice? The tzedakah, did he, to how many people? To all his people. 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 That's what he did. You have no kingdom without. He taught that to Shlomo. I'll prove in my bath. I may study in the wee hours because I want you all to be fed. And I want you to judge my words. Judge them according to Torah. That's why Yah allow you to read something. And he brings about the affirmation. One read it. And then this man talks about it. There's two. It affirms the validity of it. He ruled, reigned over all Israel. And he ruled the kingdom by the pillars of Yah. Judgment and justice. You have no kingdom without judgment. You have no truth without judgment. You have no kingdom without justice. You have no kingdom. Justice or the sadaqa, the sadiq, sadiqim. It is all the characteristics of Yah. The character or the image of Yah must be in his kingdom. His image. Although you don't see him in a physical form, his image must be there. As he said, we were reading the other night, Zachin and Akshimri and I, that the image, there's an image over the whole world. Every nation has an image. Every nation. Chesel, chesel. An image of idolatry. The only way we're going to understand this is through the proliferation of wisdom among our Zachin, men that fear Yah. She identified that this was a queen, Queen of Sheba. She brought gifts that were beyond. It was two things that basically that the temple or the house of Yah was built from. Two things, two of the precious ore. It was gold and silver, everything. And it was a wood they call shittim, shittim wood. So there were the natural ore and the wood that was the gold and the, it's basically the same thing when you use the word gold or silver. And the shittim wood, just like in every great house, there are all kinds of vessels. Gold, silver, wood, clay, zakein, talk, a dynamic message. Just listen to it again. Vessels of honor and vessels of dishonor. But Shirak gives us a profound wisdom of this whole matter here. He gives us some of the attributes of wisdom. And a man can only ascertain wisdom by knowledge of Torah. You don't get wisdom by just talking and laughing and think you got something. But hear this if you don't have the book of Shirak, chapter 24, verse 1. And then I'm going to drop down to verse 32 quickly. It says, first of all, the hukmah or wisdom shall praise Almighty Yahweh. That's what it says, Yisrael. Shirak 24:1. Are you praising Yah? Do you praise Yah? Or is that just a superficial type of action or reaction? But when a man has wisdom, he will praise Yah. It says, wisdom praise Yah, and it will rejoice in the middle of her people. When wisdom is in the mind of a nation of a people, it rejoices in the power of Almighty Yah. It rejoices in the kingdom blessing because that mind is a mind that has been trained and operates in the power of Torah. When a man doesn't rejoice, when a man is not happy, He has no wisdom. That's just a fact. He has no wisdom. I don't give a damn what he says. He can pretend. Then he says in verse 32 of the same chapter of Sirach. This is wisdom speaking now. Look what wisdom says. I will again make Musa, or instruction of teaching of doctrine, shine forth like the dawn. When a man has the instructions of God's wisdom, it shines forth out of him like the dawn. He said, well, shine forth like the dawn. And I'll make it shine afar. When one has that, one sees one coming before they approach them. You rise in the morning early when the sun begins to rise, you see it, and the light began to flow. When you see the full moon, the children, when they see that, they get ecstatic. Look at that light. One night we came out of the tabernacle. Oh, Poppy. Tell your daddy, I'm not walking. Daddy, take them down there. Let them take pictures of the moon. See, that's how we shine in the midst of the moon. That light shines in the nighttime, right? That's how we shine when we have the wisdom of God. This is wisdom speaking now, okay? This is what it says. Now, this is what wisdom does. In verse 33, he said, I will again pour out, or shafak, pour out teachings. This is what wisdom does. Like Nabuah, Sirach 24:33. I will pour out teaching like prophecy, yeah? And leave it. Why? This is so important for us. I will leave it to all future generations. Nabuah. And the only way we're going to understand Nabuah, we must have the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. You do not have that testimony without the pillars of that power that is judgment and justice. You can erect your dirty little damn Jesus, your filthy little damn God, but you don't have the testimony, the Eruth of Yahshua HaMashiach. He said, I will pour out the teaching. This is what wisdom says. So when we that are wise men, I don't want to die. I said like this, I don't want to die with what I do know without pouring this out, shafak. Let it be like libation. Let it just flow out of my loins. I don't want to die that way. I'm not begrudging or begruntled. I can teach whatever I know. I want to teach it. I don't want to know how to do something I can't teach and show, and so that others will have that knowledge. You all will have it in case Yah removes me from the scene. He said, I will pour it out. For what? To leave it for all future generations. For what reason? Observe that I have not labored for myself alone. This is wisdom talking now. But for all who seek Hubakash, who seek the wisdom of Yah, this skill of this wisdom, this hukmah to fight the battle of faith and instructions. That's what wisdom speaks. That's what Shlomo had. That's why he judged. And that's why he did it with justice. That's why David poured that into him. And that's why the prototype of David's kingdom and the beginning of the kingdom of Shlomo, it was only until Rehoboam came in the power that the kingdom was divided. It is only when you began to bring your damn filthy, stupid, immature ways in, you divide the truth. That's what Rehoboam represented. Instead of listening to the Zachim, he listened to those that it was equal because he thought he was smarter than them. And most men like to listen to people that they think that they're smarter than. You don't want to listen to somebody that's smarter than you. I like to listen to men that are smarter than me. I like to talk to men that are smarter than me. You talk all the time. Well, you're not around me. If you're around me, you realize I don't talk much. I talk when I need to. But when you're around me, I don't talk much. When I work, I don't talk much at all. I'm attentive to what I do. I don't talk much when I'm working. I work. I know how to work and talk. I don't have to stop working to talk. As a matter of fact, when I'm talking, I work fast and it energizes me. Most people cannot do that. That's what wisdom teaches. That's why a man is happy. Because all of the Nebuah, it is for this generation. And so because we guard the Torah, we understand the beauty, we judge ourselves and we keep the justice of Yah, because we know that the power of that kingdom, the testimony of Yahshua is in us. We know that Yisra Yah. And if we don't have the power, that testimony, that Edah, that kingdom power, you know you have it because there's judgment always refreshes you. to do right, to walk in the character of Yah, it always make you happy. When you do wrong and you're happy, something is wrong with you. He that knoweth to do tough, or do tough and doth not, it is a sin. You know what is right to do, you don't know it's a sin. She did me wrong. Oh, shut your damn mouth. Nobody did you wrong. Well, you know, he said that we hurt my feelings. Damn your feelings. I'm glad they were hurt. Tell me what he said so I can hurt him again. This is the stupidity of this generation. Because they think they're wise. They're conceited. They're wise in their own conceit. I'm going to close in a moment. All right. Hallelujah. Listen to this and what David says. This is one of the most important things that Yah loves, because he knows this is one of the strongest pillars of his kingdom. That's why he used the word judgment first. David says here in Tehillim, Psalm 37, 28. It says this. Psalms 37, 28. Yah loves us, doesn't he? But Yah loves judgment. Does it say that? Yah loves mishpats. Does he love judgment? Because when everything else fell, judgment is going to stand. Yah loves judgment. And it tells us, and he will not azab, he will not abandon his kedushim or his hasid, his faithful one. A hasid, well, kedushim is one that is faithful. That's what this woman, this queen could see in the sons of Shlomo of Yisrael. He said, they are Shema, they are guarded. They are preserved forever. But the seed of the Rasha, they're going to be cut off. The seed of the wicked are going to be cut off, Yisrael. They're going to be cut off. That's why we need men that are skilled in the knowledge of Torah. They can teach us judgment and justice. We need to understand judgment and justice. We need to understand the prophecy of the Nebuah of this book. We need to understand that, and we can see everything in the book. It deals with judgment and justice. You think you're getting by, baby, but you have not gotten by. You can hide it all you want to, but it's coming again. Your sins are going to find you out. Your sins are going to find you out. You can pretend all you want to. He loves judgment, Yisrael. And because he loved judgment, that is one of the great pillars of his kingdom power. We must love judgment. We must love to judge ourselves, Yisrael. We must. Hallelujah. And when we began to develop ourselves by that Ruach, the prophet Ezra, he speaks, write this down, all of you, in the second book of Ezra, chapter 8, verse 7. The second book of Ezra. I want you all to read this. It says in Ezra, chapter 8, verse 7. It says, for Ezra was a very skilled. Was not that the indication of the definitive of what a jurist is? He or she is a person that is skilled in the jurisprudence, the wisdom of the science of law, that they can operate with the volume of that wisdom, with jurisprudence. They can speak it, they can elaborate, and they can do with erudition, with the proficiency of one that is very wise in knowledge of every matter that come before them. But it says here that Ezra, this is for us older men. This is for you young men. It says for Ezra had great skills. Do we all have great skills in the knowledge of Torah? I know I don't. But we all think we have great skills, don't we? It says, it uses the word gadol. It says Ezra had very great skill. You know that, so when we talk to each other, you can't omit some of the things that are in the sentence. You don't have great skills if you omit that word and that word and that word and that word. If you can only see three words. It says he had very great skills, so that he omitted nothing of the Torah and the commandments of Almighty Yahweh. And he taught Yisrael the ordinance, the justice. That's what ordinance complies with, and judgment. That's what a skilled man teaches. He teaches the ordinance, the righteous. What is your limitation? That's what justice is. That's what a skilled man. We don't have skilled men today. We don't have men skilled in the Torah. Write it down. In 2 Ezra 8, 7, he was skilled. And that's what a jurist is. He's a skilled man. Because he has jurisprudence. He has wisdom and knowledge of law, how it interacts. He has knowledge of Torah. He has knowledge of justice, of Torah. And he used the wisdom of that, or the prudence of that, to judge a case. And the judges are hold. This is simple, isn't it? Even a simple man like me can understand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Here's a statement here in 1 Melachim, 1 King, chapter 6, verse 11 and 12. This is what was commanded to Shlomo by his Avat, David. And I'm going to close from one of the verses here in 1 King. But 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 11. Now the whole task neath the pattern of the tabernacle was given unto David. He handed it down to Shlomo. Every aspect, every flower, every lion, every image that was in there. Let nobody kid you, Yisrael. Anytime we bow down to anything that has no life or no breath, we can assault something like this. Come on, we got to examine ourselves. There's no life in these damn images here. And everything you look at Torah, when it talks about images and everything, it deals with one thing, bowing down to worship. Everything about us is full of images, everything. Look what it says here in 1 Kings 6:11. It said, the word of Yah came to Shlomo. It bold, it entered in, saying, now listen what he says, concerning this house, this bed, which you are building. This is what he said him now. He didn't correct nothing in the building of the house. I want to show you this, what he says. We're still talking about judgment and justice. He said, if you will walk in my hucha, my statutes. And he said, I want you to execute what he says, my judgment. Is that what it says? He said, my judgment, and keep all my justice. That's what the commandments are. Are not these mitzvah the justice of Yah? Are not these mitzvah the justice of Yah? And you keep all my mitzvah to walk in them. Then I will perform my word with you, which I spoke unto David, your avat. He said, if you just keep my judgments and do all of my commandments, my justice, I will perform the same thing with you. What did David do? He kept judgment and justice. And that was the rule of the kingdom, and the house was one, wasn't it? And before David died, he gave this solemn charge. This, what the Torah calls Mabeth, or Sava Mabeth. He says this, 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 1. I'm going to close from this reading. 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 1. Now the days of David, they draw karab. They draw close. He had entered into the stage of death. He knew he was dying. It says that he should muth, he should die. He should cease from this life. 1 Kings 2:1. And it says that he charged, he gave command, he gave an obligation unto Shlomo for service. First of all, to him to be watchful, he charged Shlomo, his son, saying, listen to this, I go the way of the earth. He tells him to be hazach, to be strong. And that's to have the confirmation of this truth in you, that you have the courage to stand, to be firm, and don't deny Yah. He say, therefore, and show yourself a man, an ish. You have physicality, you have strength, you have beauty. You don't let the women take you away from the Torah of Yah, that you began to be a groza, and Yah is going to cause the whole house through your very seed to bring death unto his nation. Now look what he says. This is what David gave to his son. And keep the charge of Yah your Abba, to walk in his derech, his ways, what he command. See, all of this is the justification of his house. He said to keep his hukha, his statutes, and his mitzvah, his commandments. This is his justice here. Is not this justice here, Yisrael? You can't steal from your neighbor. You can't lie. It's not that justice. It's not that justice with him. He says to keep his commandments and his judgments, and his mishpatim, and his mishpatim, and his testimonies, his eduth, and it is written in the Torah of Moshe. We see the Torah or the spirit of prophecy in Yeshua written in the Brit Hadassah, do we not? He said, you must keep all that for what? That you may shachal, you may prosper. You may be rich, you may rejoice. You may be prudent and wise. You may use the jurisprudence of Torah to abrogate, to straighten out every situation, that you may be sochal in all that you do and wheresoever you turn yourself. We will never be sochal. We will never be wise without that, the pillars of foundation of the testimony of Yeshua in us. And we know we have that foundation and the pillar and the pillars. When we have, oh, I know what all the mitzvah, what they rest upon, these, all the commandments, I know that. We're talking about you cannot even have that if you don't even have the judgment and the justice of Yah. We have opportunity to do tough by all men, but especially Yisrael Yah. So that's why I greeted them from around the world when out of this nation they denounced those on the continent of Africa and Russia and China. I greet you everywhere. And those that are in this nation will not send one damn dime. And Yah calls one from an east country of Africa to send an offering. I'll tell you what the offering was. It was $155.50. That's a lot of money. They sent that kind of money, $155.50. And there are those that are listening, will not send one damn dime. They will get fat today like greedy pigs. I don't take it back. You can get all kinds of sermonette soothing teachings, but you don't get truth. This is truth today, pure truth. And I don't take one word back. You understand? May Yah riches rest upon you all. Yisrael Yah, we greet you all. May Yah bless you all. May the riches of Yah rest upon you. Come on, my Zakin. We appreciate you all joining us on the live broadcast. May Yah strengthen you all and keep you in Yahshua's name. Yah barak my Zakin Shimri. Your house and all in Yeshua's name. Yeah.
We told Yahweh for that word of strength, encouragement, great wisdom. You know, we as a people, as I said last night, Yisrael Yah, we must allow Yahweh to teach us, Raha, to show us, to reveal unto us. And we need to stop all the resisting. Yahweh, he has given us men. He has given us Reah. He has given us pastors after his own left. Just as he spoke about Dawid, even in the building of his house and how he passed those same plans unto Solomon. Hallelujah. It is Yahweh that Raha. He shows us, Yisrael Yah, how to live, what pleases him, how to build up our emunah. He teaches us by his Torah. He feeds us, Yisrael Yah. Were not we fed today, Yisrael Yah? That is Yahweh showing us. Raha, it's the same word. Pronounced the same way, Yisrael Yah. So let us receive of Almighty Yahweh, and we shall be blessed. We shall be barak of him, Yisrael Yah. Let us stand to our feet. Hallelujah. For Yahweh, he is tough, and his mercies endureth forever. Hallelujah. His long suffering. Let us shub to Yerushalayim. Abba Yahweh, we do barak you for this beautiful Shabbat you have given us, Abba Yahweh. You have fed us well. Your hava has been poured out upon us this day, Abba Yahweh. And again, we do ask that your ruach would rest upon Kol Yisrael, those that are in their homes, Abba Yahweh, that you would visit them on this day, that you barak Yisrael, and that you would give us beautiful rest and reassurance in Yahshua HaMashiach. And all things we do barak you, we give you todah. In the precious name of Yahshua HaMashiach, we do declare, hallelujah, 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 Yahweh, hallelujah. Yah barak Kol Yisrael, hallelujah.